I'm so excited to be here this evening. Isn't it amazing? Women gathered together, ready to pick up their swords, ready to put on the full armor of God and serve Him. Amen. Let's just begin to welcome the Holy Spirit into our midst. Let's welcome the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Let's welcome Him this evening. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Holy Spirit, we praise you. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. We give you the adoration. You, Lord, are awesome. You, Lord, are wonderful. You, Lord, you're worthy of it all, Lord. You, Lord, are great. Lord Jesus, we worship you. We honor you. We praise you. Psalm 150, verse 6 says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let's just praise Him. Let's praise Him. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Let's just continue in that atmosphere of tongues, if just to encourage you guys, just to speak in tongues. And for those of you who can't speak in tongues just yet, just put the name of Jesus on your mouth. Just say Jesus, Jesus, Jesus over and over again. But for those of you who can speak in tongues, just encourage you just to speak in tongues. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus. I encourage you guys to keep on pushing through. Keep on speaking in tongues. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus. King Jesus, King Jesus. Hebrews 12, verse 2 says, fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus. We fix our eyes on you, King Jesus. So turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful faith and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Turn your eyes, turn upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful faith and the things of earth will grow strangely. When Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus and Martha was fussing around and she was distracted, Jesus said, Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken from her. So just to encourage everybody here that, and we look out, we fix our eyes on Jesus, when we just sit at his feet, the things that we will receive from him will never be taken away from us. This is not time wasted. For those of you who came and sacrificed to be here, I believe the Lord is saying your time isn't wasted. And what you receive from tonight will not be taken away from you. So once again, I just want to encourage you guys to turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look for in his one.
We'll keep you. You are the
welcome you here, Lord Jesus. So come have your way. Come have welcome you here, Lord Jesus. So come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Come have your way among us. Make it your prayer. Welcome you here, Lord. Make it your prayer. So come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Sins of the world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow. So comes to save, to heal, to set the captives free. Who can stop the love? Open up the gate, open up the gate. Make way before the King of Kings. King of Kings, you are welcome here. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives. He is the Lord. Forever his truth shall reign, and heaven and earth rejoice. exalted. The King is exalted on high. He is Lord. He is the Lord. Forever His truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in His holy. The King is exalted on high. He is the Lord. He is the Lord. Forever His truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in His holy name. He is exalted. Exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise Him. He is exalted, the King is exalted, and I will praise His name. The King is exalted on high. He is the Lord. He is the Lord. Forever His truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in His. Hey!
opportunity to sing a new song to the Lord, to pour out our praise. Break open the alabaster jar. Break open the alabaster jar. Sing your praise to the King. Sing your praise to the King.
Pour out our praise. Day and night, night and day, let Sun so rise. And day and night, night and day, let Sun so rise. And day and night, night and day, you are worthy of it. deserve the glory. Yes, let's clap unto the Lord. so calm and bowed down. This is holy ground.
Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus.
This is holy ground.
Let's just connect with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
This
Let's just bring our request to Him right now. We're in His presence. He is here. He is here. He is here. Oh Lord, we worship You, Lord. We worship You, Lord. We worship You, Lord. Lord, we worship You. We praise You, we exalt You. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Thank You, King of Kings. And thank You, Lord of Lords. Lord, we bow down. We bow down and worship You. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Wow. God is here. He is here. He is here right now. Lord, we thank You. Lord, we praise You. We worship You, Lord. We worship You, Lord Jesus. This is holy ground, Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, King of Kings, and thank You, Lord of Lords. Lord, we thank You. As I was sitting in my seat, I just thought, January has gone. February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, and we're in October. Lord, we are grateful. Lord, we are grateful, Lord Jesus. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Wow, let's just give a round of applause. The worship was powerful. God is in this place. Wow. Well, so let us take our seats. Hallelujah. So I'm excited. I'm really excited about this evening. I'm excited about what is to come. This is our second event of Radiance. And wow, God has been good. God has been good. So I'm really excited for the next part of this evening. Now, before I introduce the speaker, I would like to honor her first. The Word of God says in Romans 13:7, to give honor where honor is due. Amen. Now, the person that is going to come to speak now, she's the mother of this house. Amen. She is a powerful woman of God. Her words carry power. Amen. She is a prophetess. She's a pastor. She's a leader. She's a visionary. Amen. She's a pioneer. She is the founder of Radiance Ministry. Amen. So let us just honor her. Let's rise to our feet and let's honor Prophetess Lakeisha. Let us just honor her as she comes up. Give a round of applause. Lord, we thank You. We honor You. We love You. You are great. You are wonderful. And we thank You for all You do.
Amen. Hallelujah. Can I be really real with you today? Is that okay? But I'm going to ask you one thing. If I'm real with you, I want you to be real back with me. And I want you to open up your hearts tonight. I just feel like there is a real sweet presence in the room. And I just want to welcome the Holy Spirit. And so Holy Spirit, I just welcome You here. Father Lord, I just don't want you to have part of this room, but I want You to have the whole room. And so, Father, I just pray You just come, that You'll just come and dwell and keep this sweet presence that's here tonight. I really feel there's a rawness, and I've been waging war all week. But first, I want to do something. There's a song on my heart that I just want to sing, and it goes like this. Gloria, you're going to have to help me. I need You, Lord, more than yesterday. I need You, Lord. More than words can say, I need You, Lord, than ever before. I need You, Lord. I need You, Lord. need you more, God.
More than words can say, I need you, Lord, than ever before. I need you more. I need you more.
If that's on your heart tonight, lift up your voice to Him. With you, what's on my heart. I don't have all the words to say. I want to be really real with you. Is that okay? Okay. So this week, I've literally had attack after attack after attack. Monday, attack. Tuesday, attack. Wednesday, attack. I'm not just talking little attacks. I'm talking big things. So by Wednesday, I literally was like, I'm done. I'm done. Is this okay? You okay? I'm done. Pastor Bianca, can you relate with me? The attacks come. It's not just little, it's big things. And I'm like, John, baby, I love you, but I'm done. I'm tapping out. I'm tapping out. I can't take no more. Like, I'm done. But do you know what he said to me? My man of strength, my rock. He comes to me and he says, babe, are you ready to hear what he says? He comes laughing. He's laughing. I'm like, don't do that. Don't do that. He goes, babe, you've got your toe stubbed and you're retreating. I was like, wow. I retreat because I'm hurt. I'm like, John, no, I'm done. I'm on the floor. Like, I'm dead. I'm done. And he goes, babe, you stubbed your toe and you retreat. So Natalie comes, joins in the conversation because she's staying with us right now. She's my Esther while she's in Nigeria. And she comes and she goes, Mama P, because that's what she calls me, Mama Pastor. Mama P, you've been going on about picking up your sword and waging war and being on the battle with us. And now you're retreating. So Thursday comes and I'm just down. And I'm like, don't talk to me. I don't want to talk to anybody. I want you to guard how I was feeling. I was like, I can't take anymore. Like, John, leave me alone. Just like, let me be. Thursday night comes, and I'm like, I'm ready to cancel Radiance. Like, I'm Natalie, put out a post, we cancel it. But God comes in the night, and this is what he says to me. He says, new season, new strategy. He says, new season, new strategy. And I was like, God, what's the new strategy? What is it? And then he goes, new levels, same devils, dressed differently. New devils, different levels, dressed differently. It's the same devils we battle. It's the same devils you battle from when you're age 15 up until 40. It's the same devils, but dressed differently. So I'm raging war. I'm like, I'm tossing and turning. I'm like, God. So he takes me to David. And he shows me this. David was a little shepherd boy. He had a slingshot, a shiny pebble, and an armor that was way too big for him. He couldn't even wear the armor. It was the king's. It was too big for him. And I'm like, God, okay, what does that mean? What does that mean? Have I got a slingshot? Like, what does it mean? And he says, Now the armor fits. Now the armor fits. New season, new strategy. Higher levels. Same devils dressed differently. But now the difference is I have armor that fits. You can't always do the same things that you've been doing with the same strategy. It doesn't work. Yes, David, he fought Goliath. He was gone. But in 2 Samuel, we see that actually, once again, he's fighting the Philistines. Same devils, higher levels. He's now a king, but dressed differently. He got an upgrade from a slingshot to a sword. So I want to tell you tonight, put down the slingshot, get dressed, put on the armor that fits you, take up your sword and fight. New levels, different devils, dress differently. So I want to declare tonight that in this season, there is a new strategy. That in this season, we will fight differently. Does this. Later on in 2 Samuel, it says, enough is enough. So once again, he goes and fights the Philistines, and then he says, enough is enough. So tonight I'm declaring, enough is enough. I will not tolerate the devils that keep coming back time and time again, because they are the same thing. They are the same devils dressed differently. So I'm declaring tonight that we will say enough is enough, and we will wait for Abishan, because Abishan came to David. He came when he was weary and exhausted. I'm weary and exhausted. I don't know how you're feeling today, this week. The fights, the battles you have, you're weary and exhausted. You know, you need to wait for the Abishan. Abishan is on his way. Help is on his way. But can I tell you, don't push your Abishan away. The help comes. God will send you the help. But do you know what we do? We keep our enemies here and push the Abishan away. When actually, no, you push the enemy away and keep the Abishans here. Help is on his way. New season, new strategy, higher level, same devils, dressed differently. Amen? Amen. So Father, Lord, I declare right now that as we enter into a new season, it's a new strategy, that we will not tolerate the same way, that we will not tolerate the same things, that we will fight differently, that we will not get our toe stubs and retreat. We will not get paper cuts and retreat. But Lord, through our pain, we pick up our swords and we fight. Yadama, sword, yadama, si, yadama. Enough is enough. Enough is enough over sickness. Enough is enough over broken marriages. Enough is enough over unemployment. Enough is enough over your sons and daughters. Yarama, Uri, Yarama, Siarama. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We will not retreat. We will not retreat. I don't know where that came from, but amen, amen. You know, through our deepest pain actually comes the greatest gain. You know, I can tell you the storm you're going through, actually how valuable you are. Do you know why? Because the devil only takes what's valuable. So I must be valuable. I must be important if the devil's going to come and attack me. The devil's not that creative. He can create a storm in your life because you're valuable. You're important. You're doing something good. You've got an assignment to fulfill. Amen. That's for free. Amen. You can take your seats. But I just want to welcome you to Radiance tonight. I really appreciate you guys coming and standing with me on the battleground. You know, things aren't always easy. things are tough. But I do not, I thank you that you are my Abba Shans. That actually you are the ones that I'm fighting war with. That we can do it together. And so having said that, actually, I can promote November's Radiance. I'm really looking forward to it. So before I welcome Pastor Bianca, let's take a look at November.
Humanity has been stained by sin, tarnished and destroyed. And the reason why I say this is because science hasn't been able to solve the issues of your heart.
You can't stop this here. You can't stop this.
Amen.
Work too hard, my God. I'm gonna play my card.
Amen. We do have a date change. It is actually Friday, November the 4th, not the 11th. So put it in your diaries. Book it on Eventbrite. There's another one you don't want to miss. Amen. But who's looking forward to hearing the word tonight? I am. But so before I want to introduce Pastor Bianca, I feel so honored and privileged that she's here with us tonight. There is an actual three-day conference going back at her home church, and she's chose to be with you girls instead. So we are privileged tonight. And so having said that, can we give a Radiance honor welcome to Pastor Bianca today? Amen. I went to one of their conferences at that church, and I heard Pastor Bianca speak, and I turned to John and I was like, I need her. I want her to come and share for you guys, because I really believe that what she carries is God-spoken, soul-piercing. And God is going to touch your life tonight. He's going to read your mail tonight. I really believe it. And so, Pastor Bianca, will you take it away for me? Thank you. Hallelujah. Wow. Wow. Hallelujah. I can feel such an anointing in this house tonight. I just want to honor your pastors. I know that you've already honored them. I love a house who knows how to honor. But it makes me giggle because I just couldn't believe that they were excited to have me here. I was telling them in the green room, when I first saw the message pop up for the invitation to come, I thought, oh, that must be for my dad. And it was not, as soon as I realized it was actually for me, I was like, oh my gosh, they want me? Like, what? So I am so beyond honored, and you guys have amazing pastors. Like that authenticity that you see right there, let me tell you, vulnerability is true strength. A lot of people put the makeup on and the mask on and come and act like they've got it all together, and it's not God that gets the glory when they do that. But the vulnerability and transparency and the authenticity of your pastors is something to value and something to honor. And so I hold you in high esteem and in high regards, and I thank you so much for this incredible honor. You guys can be seated. Ah, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Well, the Lord sent me with a word here tonight, and it's something God's really been speaking to me about. I'm a pastor from my home church a couple of hours away in traffic, only an hour away when it's not. But I also lead up our Bible school, and so I am known as a little bit of a Bible geek. I love studying the Word of God, and so I love revisiting scripture that I've already preached on and saying, Lord, show me something new. Show me something new, because the Word is alive and it's living and it's sharper than a two-edged sword. And so every time you go into the Word, because it's alive and living, mixed with the Holy Spirit who's your teacher, there will forever be something new in there you haven't seen before. And so the Lord recently took me to the book of Esther. Whew, and I thought, how fitting for a ladies' meeting. See, we see the book of Esther begin with this king. It's a king called King Xerxes, and he's a little bit of a weak king. He's very easily influenced by those in leadership underneath him. How many of you have seen that happening in this day? Those who are in positions of authority, yet are just the face of the operation and not the brains of the operation.
And so this is what's happening is King Xerxes is easily influenced by the so-called wisdom of those underneath him, which is always a dangerous thing. Let me remind you tonight, because the church should be the leaders, right? We should be the leaders. We should be the head of operations. We should be infiltrating every seven mountains of influence, and we should be the one governing and ruling and reigning. We are priests, but we are also kings. But there is a stark difference between leading and governing, and this was the failure of this king, influenced by those underneath him. He may have been leading, but he wasn't the one governing. Come on. There is an authority that you carry to govern, to dictate. You decide the terms. You decide the atmosphere. You decide the laws. You decide the rules. You decide what happens with your kids. When you're a parent, you're not just the face of the operation. It's your job as a parent to say, you will not leave this house dressed like that. You will not stay out till those hours. You will not go do that on a Sunday. You're going to the house of the Lord. It's not just leadership. It's governing. Amen. And so we have this King Xerxes, and Esther opens up with this extravagant party that he's throwing. And the Lord showed me something so interesting here. It says, in the third year of his reign, he gave a banquet for all of his nobles and officials. And he invited, it tells us specifically who invited. He invited the military officers of Persia and Media, as well as the princes and nobles of the provinces. So he has this gathering of people, and who he brings in to his company in this gathering are the nobles and the princes, in other words, people of authority, people of influence, and the military. In other words, the people with enforcement power, those in positions of influence, and those in positions of enforcement. But not just of anywhere. It tells us specifically of Persia, which is modern-day Iran, and Media. King Xerxes, this king, in fact, his grandfather was Persian, and he proclaimed himself, self-proclaimed, as the king, not of Persia, which he was, but the king of the world. In other words, not the kingdom of God, not the godly, the world, the world systems, the world structures, the world orders, anti-kingdom, anti-Christ. So here we have modern day Iran, the rule and reign and agenda of the world, and Media. I don't know who hasn't quite got it yet. Media. There is an anti-Christ, anti-kingdom, anti-purity, anti-holiness, anti-sanctification, anti-salvation agenda in the media. Just recently, Disney released one of its most popular films in a TV series. And in this TV series, you actually see a girl, a child, a young teenager, an adolescent go into a high school gender-neutral bathroom with an adult, not teen, an adult male to consult her about her menstrual cycle. They are now pushing this agenda in middle schools, not even just high schools anymore, middle schools all across America for gender-neutral bathrooms and changing rooms, where a 12-year-old girl could be in there with an 18-year-old man. Disney have had audio released lately, just in the last few months. Disney have released audio where they have proclaimed that they have an LGBTQ agenda for at least a minimum of 50% leadership roles in the next couple of years. They also publicly opposed a law in Florida where their Anaheim base is, and their, not their, in California, in Florida, where their Disney headquarters base is. And it was called the anti-children campaign of sexualization. They opposed it. Why? There was an agenda to infiltrate schools where they would be able to teach sex education to children at the age of 4 and 5. And I'm not just talking about how things work. I'm talking about specific details to sexualize children without the knowledge or consent of their parents. And so when there was a stand made against this law, Disney have publicly stated that they will not rest until they eradicate that. How can you base your business on children and hopes and dreams, yet publicly make a stand for their against their protection? The media has been infiltrated and the church needs to wake up. It just takes us to have one quick look at the news. The Bible says that in the last days, many's hearts will fail them for what? For fear. In the news today, you cannot turn on the news without seeing false evidence. What is the analogy? What is that symbol for fear? It's false evidence appearing real. It gets even more interesting. Remember, media is the plural for medium, which is to channel something spiritually. Now, biblically, we know that Persia was modern-day Iran, and we know what was going on there with the world agenda. Media was actually the province most well-known for culture and politics. In fact, if we look at Daniel's prophecy, it shows Media and Persia as the two rams of the same goat. So here we have the world systems, the world agenda, coupled with politics and culture to channel an antichrist agenda. It's the exact, I love that, the same devil dressed different. Remember, the devil is just a fallen angel. He's a created being. He's not equal and opposite of the Lord. He's just a created being. And so after all of this time, this is something so key I've learned and I've stuck to. The devil will always attack you the last place he had success. And so if he had success, he will continue to attack you in the same place. And so we can see the devil, he's not the creator. He's not the great I am. So he consistently recycles the same strategy. It's exactly what we see here, the two horns on the same ram. And so what happens at this party, I'm sure many of you are familiar with it, King Xerxes, he's showing off, and he decides to bring in his wife, Queen Vashti, and flash her off to everybody, and she decides just not to play ball. She doesn't want to do it. And so King Xerxes, being manipulated again and influenced by those in leadership underneath him, decides to get rid of his wife, and then we see him initiate this beauty contest to select himself a new wife. It's at this point that we see Esther. But Esther wasn't her real name, her original name. Her original name was Hadassah. I don't know if you've looked into that before, but Hadassah actually means myrtle, like a myrtle tree. It's an evergreen tree. And so here we have Esther or Hadassah, and Hadassah had a very obscure upbringing when you consider a queen. She was a poor Jewish exiled orphan raised by her cousin. But she was a myrtle tree. She was Hadassah. Hadassah is an evergreen tree. So no matter what the circumstances, no matter what the abandonment, no matter what the pain, no matter what the trauma, no matter who was with her, no matter who left her, no matter what the experiences were, no matter what the enemy threw at her, no matter what hell's agenda against her was, she was an evergreen tree. And so she bloomed, and she bloomed, and she bloomed. And when the devil raged around her, she just kept blooming. And when hell got harder, she just kept blooming. And this is what it is to be a child of God, where you bloom in season and you bloom out season. You can bloom in a pandemic. You can bloom in a famine. You can bloom in a divorce. You can bloom in a betrayal. You can bloom in the cold. You can bloom on the mountaintop. You can bloom on the valley. She was an evergreen. We don't have to be dictated to by the circumstances on the outside. That's how churches and ministries like yours and mine are still blooming and still growing when others are being shut down, because we are not fall victim to our circumstances, but we're evergreens. Doesn't matter what your circumstances are, you bloom. You bloom. You bloom. And in the right time and in the right season, the Lord unveils. Esther means to be hidden or to be concealed. That's the meaning of the word Esther. And so what might feel like seasons of being overlooked, seasons of being forgotten, seasons of feeling left behind, where it looks like everybody else is getting to where they should go, and everybody else is getting the promotion, and everybody else is getting the marriage or the baby or the kids or the job or whatever the case may be. In those seasons, we know that Esther, throughout this season, this period of her life, that she'd experienced all of these painful circumstances. Bible says she was concealed for her own protection. Delay is not denial. Delay is not denial. If God said he would do it, he will do it. If God promised you, if you have a word from the Lord, it may feel like you've been overlooked by everybody else, but you haven't been overlooked. You've just been hidden. And it's not to punish you. It's not been to discourage you. It's not been to torment you. It's been for your own protection, so that you bloom in the right season and God promotes you where he needs to put you. And so Esther, here, she gets selected to be part of this beauty contest. But while this is going on, there's a troublesome situation. There's a man called Haman, and he's elected to be prime minister. And whilst he's elected to be prime minister, he has a real issue with a group of people. See, Haman was part of the Amalekites. And this was the same body as people. They were the first group of people to oppose the children of God when they were entering into their promised land. And so this hatred, this battle, went back centuries. But it was also personal for Haman. When he was made prime minister, he put a decree out that everybody had to bow to him. And they did but one. Esther's cousin, Mordecai. He refused to bow. He said, I bow to one. I bow to one. And the threat came, compromise or be killed. And Mordecai said, I will never compromise. I bow to one. This is the kind of faith that we need to have, particularly in this day and hour, that says, I will not compromise. If the order is ever given to give in, to bow down, to compromise or be killed, I know where I'm going. So Mordecai refuses to compromise. So what happens is Haman ends up going to King Xerxes, and he says to him, he says, hey, listen, King Xerxes, there's a little bit of a situation. He says, there's a group of people who are becoming an inconvenience. They're becoming a nuisance to us. And so we're going to have to kill them to get rid of them. I came to tell you tonight, and even to your pastors, it's a good day when you're on hell's hit list. The attack came because Mordecai was a nuisance to the devil. I don't know why we do, myself included, still get discouraged, disheartened, and downcast when we find ourselves in seasons of attack. It is a good day when you're a nuisance to the devil. I would never want to be anything other than a nuisance to the enemy. If I did not wake up and make the devil want to run 10 miles away from me, I would not be operating in what God had called me to be. The attack came because he was a nuisance to the enemy's agenda. Come on, who's ready to be on hell's hit list, no matter what the cost is? So it says at this point, Mordecai hears about this plan to kill off the Israelites. It says in Esther 4, When Mordecai learned about all that had been done, he tore his clothes, put on burlap and ashes, and went out into the city, crying with a loud and bitter wail. He went as far as the gate of the palace, for no one was allowed to enter the palace while wearing clothes of mourning. And all the news of the king's decree reached all the provinces, and there was great mourning amongst the Jews. They fasted, they wept, and they wailed. They fasted, they wept, and they wailed. That word wailed, I looked that up in the Greek, actually means to convene publicly. So when the attack came against the church, they didn't run away and hide. There has been such an antichrist agenda through this pandemic and COVID-19 and everything else going on to prevent the church from convening publicly. You can't tell me that it was deemed safe to go to a garden center, that it was deemed safe to go to a nightclub, that it was deemed safe to go to a cinema, but not to go to the house of the Lord. We have to wake up and see that culture and politics are right now channeling the Antichrist agenda, and we have to be prepared to make a stand and say, we will fast, we will weep, we will wail, and we will gather. Unified together. Says when Queen Esther's maids and eunuchs came and told her about Mordecai, she was deeply distressed. She sent clothing to him to replace the burlap, but he refused it. See, Esther was deeply distressed by Mordecai's display. She was deeply distressed, extremely uncomfortable with his public display of pain. And so she sent clothes to cover it up. There can be no more cover-ups in the church. Far too often, this is what happens. We become too uncomfortable to expose. She was uncomfortable with him being exposed publicly, and so she just sent clothes to cover him up. We can no longer cover things up in church. You can't just put on your glad rags and want to sit yourself on the pew and happy clap your way to next week. We can no longer be too uncomfortable to go outside and make a public spectacle and a public stand against the mutilation of confused children. We can no longer be too uncomfortable to go out, stand, and expose the evil in racism. We cannot be too uncomfortable to make a spectacle of ourselves on the street corners to save those right now staggering to hell. We cannot cover it up. It says Mordecai refused it. He said, I'm not going to cover this up. I'm not going to sit quietly. I'm not going to sit here and watch all of hell be let loose around me. We have to refuse the cover-up and make a stand. So Esther says to him, she said, I can't go in and fight for our lives. If I go in and fight for the Jewish people, I'll be put to death. See, what the Lord really spoke to me about here is the contrast between this. Remember, these were two cousins. Mordecai and Esther were cousins. They were related, but they were very different. This whole scene we're looking at right now is in the middle of a beauty contest. While Mordecai is out in the streets fighting, Esther right now is sitting in the spa. The same family. Very different. For me, this is a picture of the church today. You've got the Mordecais standing up, rising up, going out into the highways and byways without consideration for their comfortability or their reputation, deciding to be that voice crying out from the wilderness, saying, prepare the way for the Lord. And then you've got the church sitting in a spa. Beautiful buildings, beautiful outfits, beautiful clothes, beautiful stages, beautiful lights. Now, I'm not against any of those things, but it's all surface level. Esther did not want to get involved in the real fight. She wanted to sit comfortable in the palace and continue the beauty contest. This is not a beauty contest, it's a battleground. This is the day and hour for us to rise up like never before. Pick up your weapons of warfare. Step out into that calling. Step out into that destiny. Begin to walk in everything God has called you to be. Decide that from today, I will wage war against the gates of hell and every agenda of the enemy, and I won't care how pretty it looks. It's the difference between the two churches. It says, Mordecai sent this reply to Esther. He says, don't think for a moment that because you're in the palace that you will escape what the other Jews are being killed. He says, in fact, if you keep quiet at a time like this, deliverance for the Jews will rise up from some other place. But you and your relatives will die. He says, you can't keep yourself safe sitting pretty in the palace. The Lord will train someone else up in your place. Today, I see too often, this is something I teach my school about all the time. I see too often people want big callings with small crosses. I know the assignment was hard for her. The threat of death was very, very, very real. I'm not minimizing what this assignment required from her and the boldness and faith that she would have to step into to fulfill what was laid out before her. But the word said, if you don't stand up, someone else will. Do not despise the calling and the assignment because it's difficult. You can't have a big calling with a small cross. If you want a big call, you've got to be ready to carry that cross. You can't have the one without the other. He said the Jews will be saved by someone else, but you and your family will die. I love how we see this in Luke. It says, if you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you let your life go, you will find it. The most dangerous place for her to be was in the palace and out of action. The Jews would have been delivered from somewhere else, but she would have died. And so what Mordecai says to her is, whilst you are there fearing for your life, you are at your greatest risk of losing it. The most dangerous place for a Christian to be is in a state of lukewarm. He'd rather you be hot or cold. Do not be lukewarm, sitting comfortable in your bath, in your hot tub, with your fancy music around you, playing dress up. It's the most, he said, deliverance for them will come, but you will die. He said to her, for you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. For such a time as this. You have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. This truly is the wake-up call and the end-time shaking for the remnant church for the last days. We are living in the last days now. See, the Bible says that no man will know the day or the hour that the Lord Jesus will return. And be very careful of those who seem to say they know it. No man will know the day or the hour, but we can know the season. I'm going to give you a warning here tonight about the hour we're living in, and the window is closing. Not even the devil knows when Jesus is coming back, but there are signs, there are prophetic words, and there is wisdom that we can gather this season. Let me give you an example. We know that we are expecting in the end times to see a one world currency, right? What are they foretelling now? A global economy crash. How would you get a one world currency unless you had a global crash and everyone started again? Through the whole pandemic, I don't know about you, but I can hardly go anywhere that accepts cash. They use the excuse of germs and transference and all the other stuff to remove cash from our society. Even a couple of weeks ago, the Bank of England started removing different notes all over again, moving to a cashless society and a one global one currency. We know that we're expecting the restriction for the mark of the beast in terms of trading, the ability to trade. Did you know that through the pandemic, they have now said to prevent future death and future sickness, to be able to treat impoverished nations, that they want to put a chip in everybody in impoverished nations, impoverished cities all over the world, so that they can monitor their temperatures and monitor their blood and monitor what their body is saying, fevers and viruses, so that they can monitor pandemic movement. We're seeing it all happen now. The devil does not know when Jesus will return. And no man can know the day or the hour, but we can tell when the infrastructure is available. This is the first time in history that the infrastructure to see the final facilitation of what we are expecting prophetically to occur before Jesus returns. This is the first time that infrastructure has been set up. In the Bible, there's something called the rule of firsts. And essentially what this means is that the first time you see something, it sets a precedent for every other time it will have the same meaning. You can see this with the fig leaf and fig tree and all the rest of it. Now we know that the world was created in 6 days and then the seventh God rested. The Bible says that one day is like 1,000 to him, right? So we know that there is the beginning and the end. Well, I don't know if you knew this. I found this out recently. That there are 2,000 years, roughly, between Adam and Abraham. And 2,000 between Abraham and Jesus. And we're right on the edge of 2,000 between Jesus and us. Now, if one day counts for 1,000, we'd be right on the end of the sixth day and approaching the seventh where he rested. No man knows the day or the hour, but we can tell the times and the seasons and from infrastructure that we are living in the last days, that the window is closing, and you have been brought to the kingdom for such a time as this. You have been brought to the kingdom to be the final remnant, that bold group of body, this nation that will go out into the highways and byways and drag them into the kingdom. This body of people, this movement that will do greater things than even Jesus did, that will operate in greater anointing than this world has ever seen, that will go out and operate in signs and wonders and miracles with the glory of God falling. You have been brought to the kingdom for such a time as this. Hallelujah. So says Esther sends this reply to Mordecai. She said to him, go and gather together all of the Jews of Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days or nights. My maids and I will do the same. And then, though it's against the law, I will go to see the king. If I must die, I must die. There are laws in place right now. I don't know if you guys know this, but we've been really pressing politically against the Antichrist agenda. They recently brought a ruling in to say that it is illegal that you will be arrested, prosecuted, and put in jail if you pray for someone confused about their identity and their gender. It is now being enforced. There are laws right now being created to silence the church and the preaching of the gospel. This is not new. Esther said there is a law that says if I speak up, I will die. You cannot allow the intimidation or the rulers of this world to prevent you from speaking the truth of the Lord. She said, go away and fast and pray for me. See, she knew that this was also a battle that she could not fight in the flesh. And so she said, you go and I go. And together we're going to pray and fast and get fired up, because I can't fight this with the flesh. I need to fight this with the fire. We cannot be a body of people expecting to go out and wreak havoc on hell and do so with the arm of the flesh. We've got to be prayed up. You've got to be fasted up. You've got to be fired up. You can't be sitting at home on a Sunday from week to week. You've got to be in the house. You've got to be under the anointing. You've got to be connected to the body. You've got to be under your pastors. You've got to be watched by the shepherd. She knew that she had to go and get herself in the fire to face what she had to face. Bible says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty in God for the pulling down of strongholds. That word mighty means endowed with divine power. The weapons of your warfare are endowed with divine power. You have divine power at your disposal. You just need to get yourself in the presence of the Lord, and you don't come out sheepish. You come out with divine power. You just need to get back into worship, and you come out with divine power. Get yourself in the fire and the anointing, and you don't come out weak and fearful. You have divine power. It says mighty in God to the pulling down of strongholds. That word pulling down means to demolish. This is the assignment for the church. Far too many believers are happy to make a dent in hell. Happy to just send some ripples. That's not the assignment. It's not what you were given divine power for. You were given divine power to demolish the gates of hell, every stronghold and every fortress, not just to make a dent, but to demolish. A stronghold is a fortress, and in battle, it would be known as their headquarters. We are to target their headquarters. We are to go to the gates of hell themselves. We are to go. This is not about being on the defense. To be a child of God is to be on the offense. He is raising up a standard, and the church is the restrainer against the gates of hell. And we are to demolish every headquarters. And so Esther says, if I must die, then I must die. But really, this is a decision every single one of us should have already made. Where we say, when I said yes to Jesus, I signed that check already. That if the need ever came, if the day ever came where my life was required from me, I signed that check the day I said yes. I said, it's no longer me that lives. It's no longer me, but it's Christ in me. The hope of glory. It's no longer me. Bianca has no holding on my life anymore, because this is just the vessel. This is a decision that we have to determine already. That if I must die, if that day ever comes, if it's ever required from me, we should be living sacrifices to God. In other words, if you are a living sacrifice, you are a walking, talking dead man. And so what happens is, when we feel a little bit of offense, when we feel a little bit of pain, when we feel a little bit angry and a little bit up in our feelings, and I'm not saying that we don't have those, our hearts should always remain soft. But that simply reveals a part of the flesh that hasn't died yet, because dead men don't scream. We are to be living sacrifices, where this flesh no longer has a say, has a weight, has an opinion, or has a hold on what I do in this life for Christ, because it's no longer me that lives, but it's Christ in me. See, this is the thing, though, that when we talk about being living sacrifices and being crucified with Christ, because this is what it is, right, to be crucified with Christ. Crucifixion is one of the only deaths that cannot be self-inflicted. And so when we talk about being living sacrifices, and we talk about living for Christ and dying to the flesh, and we talk about being crucified with Christ, you've got to remember that this will often be at the hands of other people. It's how crucifixion happens. Someone holds the hammer. Someone else holds the nails. Someone else has the sword. Someone else has the crown of thorns. Someone else is around you mocking and jeering and laughing. This is what it means to be crucified with Christ, that you have to be prepared to pay the price, whatever the cost may be. And I can tell you tonight, church, our God is always faithful. He'll never waste one tear. He'll never waste one battle. He'll never waste one challenge. But if you feel tonight that you've been facing a heavy cross, I want to tell you, it's because you've got a big calling. You've got a big calling. You've got a big calling. And you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this. This is the day and the hour for you to step out. Sign that check tonight. Say, Lord, I thought I'd signed it, but yesterday I failed. Tonight, God, I'm signing that check. Shall my pride be required of me? Shall my blood be required of me? Shall my humility be required of me? Shall my reputation be required of me? Shall my life be required of me? I signed that check. What it is to be an Esther. Tonight you've all called to be Esther. You are all called to the kingdom to rule and to reign. You're called to save a nation. You're called to save, whether it's your family, your children, your marriage, those in influence, the people at your workplace. You are called to deliver. That is your job as a child of God, to deliver, to touch, to heal, to save, and to restore, to lay hands on the sick and to see them heal, to see them recover. You are called to be the mouthpiece of the Lord, to speak the truth, to see the captive set free, to shame the devil, to expose his operation. That is your assignment as an Esther. Jesus said, work while it's still day, because nighttime is coming. I want to leave you with that tonight. It's still day right now, but nighttime is coming. I don't want to be someone that God called to great things, and when I get to heaven, I find out someone else is wearing my crown. That he raised someone else up in my place because I was too offended. Or I was too tired. I was too upset. I didn't want to do it anymore. I don't want to get to heaven and have someone else wear my crown. You have been called and it is still day. But I want to tell you tonight, church, nighttime is coming. It is fast approaching. Jesus is coming soon and very, very, very soon. We no longer have time to play games and be in beauty contests, but it's time to go into battle. And so tonight, I believe that the Lord is going to set his fire on hearts again right now, that you're going to have that spirit of might come on you tonight. Will you say, God, whatever the cost, whatever the weight, it may feel too heavy for me tonight, but Lord, you're going to give me supernatural might to strengthen my shoulders. I don't want a lighter cross. I want tougher arms. And so tonight, I just want to ask you all to stand. Kushanda da satataka sendere sukushiende. Kia da sundo kushi andara satataka sendere soto kushiende. Keshendere si andara soto kushi andara sataka sendere sakashundo. I heard the Lord say tonight that there was a group of people, a few different groups of people he wanted to speak to release. I heard one group of people that have claimed Esther as their identity and forgotten that they were Hadassah. That your season of being hidden has brought you to believe that you forfeited the call. I heard the Lord say that sometimes a weapon is concealed, but it's still dangerous. That tonight he was saying you're still armed and you're still dangerous. That just because you've been through a season where it feels you've been hidden, don't forget your Hadassah. Don't forget you've been blooming. I heard the Lord say that there was a group of people tonight that he wanted to break free from superficial faith. Well, you know you've been caught up in the motions and the glory and the goosebumps. And please hear me tonight. This is not out of any condemnation whatsoever. But the Lord said he wants to break you out of your comfort zone to promote you into your calling. You can't have your comfort zone and your calling at the same time. If you want to step into the call of God, you've got to step out of your comfort zone. And the Lord said tonight that he wanted to endow with that supernatural divine power to everyone in this room. That some of you have felt burdened by the hairy cross that you're carrying, and you've allowed the discouragement of what you've experienced to make you lose sight of the great calling that God has for you. And tonight he's saying, you've been asking him to lessen the load, and he's not going to lessen the load, but he's going to strengthen you to carry it. That this will not be something you'll fall for, that you won't fall for it. You won't forfeit it, but tonight that you're going to carry it, and you're going to carry it well. So tonight, if you fit in any of those categories, maybe you're here tonight and you're saying, Lord, I can say honestly that tonight I know I've never signed that check. That, Lord, I thought I did perhaps. Maybe you said that you'd live for Jesus, but to die for him is another thing. And I believe the Lord wants to touch you tonight, and you can respond to that right now. You're here tonight and you're just saying, God, I want to be a part of this final movement, this end time army. Lord, I don't want to go to heaven and have everybody else wear a crown and I feel like I did nothing. But I want to leave this earth empty, having given it all, laid it all down, carried any cross you asked me to carry, gone out and preached till I had no breath left in my lungs. I want to know that, God, that when I get to heaven, I get there empty. I get there spent, that I save nothing for myself. Then right now, if you're in any of those categories, I just want you to come forward and respond to the Lord.
Yeah, come. If any of those words that resonated with you tonight, we just want to lay hands on you. We're going to pray with you. We're going to believe God's going to speak to you. Wow, awesome word. Now is the time. Now is the time. Yarama, si yarama.
ashes of defeat, the resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I rise from the ashes of defeat. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. The resurrected King is resurrecting me. I will arise from the ashes of the
I
beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. Thank you. You're the name we lift it high. Your glory shaking up the earth and sky. Revival. We wanna see your kingdom here. We need to see your kingdom here. King Jesus, you're the name we're lifting high. Your glory shaking up the earth and skies. Revival. We want to see your kingdom here. Lord God, we need to see your kingdom here. King Jesus, you're the name we're lifted high. Your glory shaking up the earth and skies. Revival. We want to see your kingdom here. We need to see your kingdom here. Spirit, break out. Break our walls down. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. Spirit, break out. Spirit, break out. Spirit, break out. Heaven, come down. King Jesus, you're the name we lift and high. Your glory shaking. Break our walls. this place erupts in praise. Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching earth. The sound of heaven touching earth. Spirit, break out. Break out. So break out, break out, break out of the walls that have confined you. So break out, move on up. It's time to arise, it's time to break through. So break. Break through. to break out, tear down those walls. It's time to break through. 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 It's time to break through.
As we were just in this atmosphere, sorry to disturb the atmosphere, but I believe God wants to do some miracles in this room. I believe he wants to heal some people. And I believe the first sort of healing that he wants to do is the healing of the heart. Is the healing of the heart. He wants to heal somebody's heart today. Is that you? Come forward. He wants to heal your heart. And the second thing that I felt was that there was somebody that couldn't extend their arms because of their shoulder. Like it's like a pain in the shoulder that you can't lift your hand past a certain point. If that's you, just lift up your hand. If that's you, just lift up your hands. That you can't lift up your hands past a certain point because of your shoulder pain. If that's you, lift up your hands. God is about to do a miracle in this room. God is about to do a miracle in this room. He's present right now, so present. He's so present. He's so present. And the last one that I got is I heard scoliosis. Scoliosis, if that's you, come to the front. It's like, I believe that's a back, something to do with the back. If that's you that has an issue with that, right now, just come to the front and we'll pray for you. We'll pray for you that you'll be healed. That you'll be healed right now. I believe that God is in this room.
I also heard as well, and I know they won't be in the room, but if you're here and you can represent them, I heard the Lord speak about sickle cell, but specifically for a nine-year-old boy with sickle cell. And so if that represents, or you can represent that boy, then just come as well, and we'll pray for you as well.
I believe there's somebody here. You know, this is such a holy moment. Don't stop and watch. Carry on praying. The Holy Spirit is here. He is. You know, I've just been serving, but I've been feeling the presence of God so strongly. He's here for sure. There's somebody here with an issue with your like wrist area, and it goes down like into your arms. If that's you, come to the front. If that's you, come to the front. So we're going to pray for these people. If you could all stretch your hands forward. So we're going to start with the heart one. I believe we need to do this corporately. So Father, right now, we declare healing to her heart. Father, we declare healing to her heart. Father, right now, we declare a new heart. Father, you're the one that has a closet of hearts in heaven. Father, take her new heart out of your closet and put it right in her heart right now in the name of Jesus. Father, place a new heart in her on right now. Father, as we have laid her hands on her, Father, replace her heart, oh God. Father, take out the heart of stone and put a heart of flesh, oh God. Father, every issue that the doctor has declared, Father, right now we declare it is not it. And Father, we declare your word is final. That, Father, her heart will function fully in the name of Jesus. A whole heart in the name of Jesus. Oh, we declare that in the name of Jesus. I want us to do this one, the one that you can't stretch. How far can you stretch your hands? It's your back. What's the... Okay. If we can all, as leaders, just all lay our hands. We can see the lump right now. But I believe that the Holy Spirit is doing it right now. We take authority. We take authority over this body, the body that was made from the earth, and we were given dominion over this earth. And right now we declare, straighten up in the name of Jesus. Spine, listen to us right now and declare, we declare that you are straight in the name of Jesus. Disappear. Follow, do this creative miracle in the name of Jesus. Follow, as we come together and we lay hands, oh God, Follow, we take authority over this in the name of Jesus. We take authority on this in the name of Jesus. We take authority over this in the name of Jesus. Follow, we take authority over it right now. And we declare, Follow, sickness go, infirmity go. The enemy, you have no hold over her. In the name of Jesus.
Okay. In the name of Jesus, we command spirit of infirmity, spirit of affliction, pain in the neck area right now, I command you come off with immediate effect. Amen. There it is. There it is. There it is. Thank you, Jesus. There it is. There it is. Test it. Test it. That pain should be gone. That should be gone.
How do you feel now? Is there something that you couldn't do before? And how do you feel now? We thank you, Jesus.
I just want you to declare it. How do you feel now?
Free.
Come on, can we give God some praise? Come on, come on, come on. We can do better than that. Give him some praise.
You know, who else is here for healing? Can you just say, are you here for healing? What's the, just here, is it a pain or? You know, I learned something, and Apostle was there, from Robbie Dawkins. It's your time to pray for the sick. You were healed to heal. So now you don't just get healed and go away. You have to heal the sick. So we want you to pray for her. For a healing. Believe that acid reflux will never come back to you in the name of Jesus. We believe at the next radiance you will have a testimony. Follow right now, we declare back pain gone in the name of Jesus. Back pain gone in the name of Jesus. Yeah. How does it feel now? I just felt like the Lord said it. How does it feel now? What couldn't you do before? It's easy. Is there something you couldn't do before? Yeah. Okay, Father, right now we declare fully to the whole back. Right now, we declare healing. We declare healing. We declare healing power of God. We say, by the stripes, you are healed. Ease her in the name of Jesus right now. Free her back. In Jesus' name. How do you feel now? It's easing. Okay. That's cool. Thank you.
What's your name? Jessica. Jessica gave her life to the Lord tonight. And I really believe that's a celebration right there. And so, Jessica, I just want to say we love you. We're really proud that you gave your life to the Lord. And God's got great things for you. Now is the time. Now is the time for you to rise up and be the Esther and the Deborah and the Mary and the Marthas in the Bible. I believe that God's called you and has a mighty, major destiny over your life. And as you stepped into salvation, you've been obedient tonight and heard the call upon your life that actually you are going to do amazing, wonderful, mighty things in His name, because you are now crowned. You are now crowned a daughter. And I really believe there's going to be favor upon your life as you step out there tonight, because what you've done here today, God's going to honor that. And so I want to honor you for giving your life to God tonight. And so, Father, I thank you for Jessica right now. Lord, I thank you, oh God, that she's committed her life into your hands, that she will walk in favor through all her days of her life. that you will start to unravel the mysteries you have over her life, oh God. That she would walk into her destiny, that she would not delay. Lord, in all the years that she's maybe delayed, oh God, and put off this decision, there's no more delay today. Like, now is the time. She was made for such a time as this. So, Lord, Father, we thank you for Jessica right now. In your mighty name, oh God, we pray. Amen.
When I was prophesying over there, I heard the Lord tell me you had a little back pain, so I should have. And you are okay. Well, that MRI scan is going to actually read there's nothing there. Okay, so get ready. So I'm about to pray for you, and once I finish praying for you, have you got pain there right now? Kind of an ache. Are you feeling pain there? Okay, so that's going to go, and the moment that goes, you know you've been healed. Yeah. Amen. Okay. Take your hand. Heavenly Father, thank you for your precious, brand new daughter. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, spirit of infirmity, spirit of affliction, all pain, all sciatic nerves that are trapped, whatever it may be, I evict you right now from this precious daughter's body in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Jesus. Can you test it for me? Should be gone. Test it. How do I feel?
It feels better, yeah.
Is there anything there still?
Now my whole body feels weird.
Walk up and down. Go and have a walk up and down. She says her body's feeling weird. That's the Spirit of God on her. The pain's gone. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, listen. What did I say to you? If the pain's gone, that's the testimony that Jesus has healed you. When you have that scan, they're going to go, we can't find anything. You go, I know, Jesus healed me. Amen.
That's a good day, huh? Salvation and healing in one day. Amen. Let's just give God glory tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I thank you, oh God. Lord, I thank you that you are a good God. And so, Father, I just release everyone here that as they go out, they will walk in favor with you, oh God. Lord, that they will step into the weekend knowing, oh God, that you are by their sides, oh God, that they were called for such a time as this. And so, Father, we release them now. We pray blessings and favor upon their lives right now, that they will take it back home and you will continue to do what you started here tonight, oh God. Lord, that tonight from here is not the end. That it will continue throughout the night. That you will give dreams of dreams. Lord, that they will have visions. That they will have heavenly downloads. Tonight, oh God. In your mighty name, Father, we pray. Amen. We have a tradition here at Radiance. Does anyone know what the tradition is? You can have some treats, yeah. But we have a tradition, and on the count of three, we say get rigged. But tonight we're going to say get radiant, because you're going to go and you're going to radiate God's glory. And so on the count of three, one, two, three, get radiant. Amen. Amen. Grab a brownie, speak to somebody on your way out.
worship you this morning, Lord. We declare together that it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.